We are waiting for the session to start. I've just posted a link in the chat box. If you click on that, you will be taken to the pre-lecture assessment and you can fill it while you're waiting for the session to start. Thank you. Please click on that. You can click on that and do the pre-lecture assessment while we are still waiting for everybody to join, and then we will start. Thank you. We will just be starting it. I'm Dr. Neha, a gynecologist working at Health Plus, and it is my absolute pleasure to welcome all of you. It's a pleasure to welcome all of you to this CME session, which is accredited by DOH for one CME hour, category one. And it's an absolute pleasure to welcome Dr. Abdul Razak. He will be presenting on hypertension, the latest updates. Dr. Abdul Razak is a consultant in cardiology and internal medicine. He's American board certified with subspecialty in cardiology, and he has years and years of experience in the USA, Syria, and the UAE. He also has a special interest in preventive cardiology, and he will today take us through the latest update on hypertension. I welcome Dr. Abdul Razak to take over and share his wisdom with us.
Thank you. Do you need me to bring that on?
Yes.
Good morning. Can I ask everyone?
Now here, please. Yeah, no problem. Or you can make it there.
Sorry, Dr. Razak. Sherry, can you please mute all the participants? Dr. Abdul Razak, you can unmute yourself and start.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much. It's really a pleasure to share the next half hour or so with you, and I will be more than happy to discuss later on any question you might have, you might ask. So what I will do in the next 30 minutes or so, get some fundamentals on the objective. I understand that we have really the audience range from physicians to nurses to different specialties. So I will try not to bore everyone with technicality. There are some slides I will read, some slides I will use them only to give some clues and some take-home messages. So by the end of this session, everyone should have a good idea about the latest guidelines for diagnosing hypertension in their patients and to interpret blood pressure monitoring charts and explain to patients how to self-monitor, which is so important, and apply the knowledge of initiating medication.
Lu'ay, Allah yirhamu Lu'ay. Ma baqi illa wajh Allah.
Heart disease remains the leading cause of death in the United States, and I believe this is also worldwide, and our region is not exception. And unless the world do something about it, I think this will continue to be the bigger killer. So it is far more than cancer, HIV, TB, diabetes, and malaria. And I think soon you will have COVID in the chart somewhere. Now, this is very interesting slide. It's from Gulf region. And you see here that the prevalence of blood pressure of hypertension in the Gulf area is around 35%. Awareness, only around 50% of people know that they have high blood pressure. Treatment offered to less than 50% of people, and this is also very disappointing. Only less than 20% of patients with high blood pressure in Gulf area, including our beloved UAE, achieve reasonable control. So I think we have big task ahead of us. This is another sad slide. This is from WHO a few years ago, and look at the red bar talking about the mortality, cardiovascular mortality in UAE compared to Germany, Thailand, USA, United Kingdom, and Singapore. Unfortunately, the mortality rate in cardiovascular disease far exceeds other nations. And I think there are a few reasons for that. I think the comorbidities, including diabetes, obesity, hypertension, and I think yet we need to have very cohesive and organized way to treat this. And I think this CME hour and other collaboration, hopefully we are in the right direction. Okay, this study, very also important study done worldwide, including UAE, and the take home message from this slide that 75% of population with hypertension have uncontrolled blood pressure. So this is again similar conclusion. Why I'm saying these things, you know, because this is, I don't want people to fear they will come today and learn how to treat blood pressure, it's a number and go home. I think this is a major issue, and I will emphasize the next few slides about diagnosis. People think that diagnosis of blood pressure is very simple. Blood pressure, the nurse checked the blood pressure, it's a number, you either have blood pressure or not. Well, let's start to have some concept on this. There are four questions now. Every patient come to the clinic with possible hypertension, we need to ask ourselves and answer that question. Is there evidence that self-directed monitoring blood pressure or ambulatory blood pressure are superior to office-based measurement? Is that important in preventing adverse outcome for which high blood pressure is a risk factor and achieve better blood pressure control? Question two, what is the optimal target of blood pressure lowering during antihypertensive therapy in adults? And the third question, in adults with hypertension, do various antihypertensive drug classes differ in their comparative benefits and harm? And the last question, not the least, that adults with hypertension, does initiating treatment with antihypertensive therapy versus initiating treatment with two drugs, either alone or separately, I mean fixed combination or separately, which may be followed by the addition of sequential drug, different comparative benefits? I think the last one is very important. We do have inertia as physicians. We start low and then we have so other things to worry about. I think we have to be more assertive in this time. These are basic information. I'm not gonna spend a lot of time. Systolic blood pressure by first Kortikov sound. I think it takes us back so many years ago. I think all of you know these things, you know, but it's nice review. By the way, all my slides are available for everyone who want to take them. So I really think the CME office can provide this to everyone. Now, the new things in the latest guidelines that we are more stringent, we are more really tight blood pressure control is recommended. So, and we have this information to digest. For instance, normal blood pressure in all should be less than systolic less than 120 millimeter mercury, diastolic less than 80. By definition, elevated blood pressure higher than those numbers. And there are two stages of hypertension, very simple. Stage one, 130 to 139, systolic or 80 to 89 millimeter mercury diastolic. Stage two, when it's more than 140 systolic or more than 190 millimeter mercury diastolic. Now, you listening to me now, remember in the last few weeks, how many patients came to your clinic with any medical illness, whether high blood pressure or any diabetes or any specialty, with blood pressure of 135 systolic or 138, with the diastolic 85, and we overlook it, and we even knock our head and tell the patient he's doing fine. No, this is stage one hypertension. Now, what is the cardiovascular risk in blood pressure? Class one recommendations. Every patient who is diagnosed with blood hypertension need to have screening for and management of other modifiable cardiovascular risk factors. So again, no matter what's our specialty, if we are well involved in this, then we can screen. If not, we need to refer. We're talking about every patient with hypertension. We should know whether he have diabetes or not, what his cholesterol level, if he's smoker or not, what his body mass index, and address those issues as comorbidities and look at it seriously. This is again class one recommendations. Measurement of blood pressure. Now people will ask, measurement? We all know how to measure blood pressure. Well, I tell you, for diagnosis and management of blood pressure, proper methods are recommended. And I don't think most of us are doing so. Why? Let's look at this quickly. I'll go over this. I think step one, we should proper prepare the patient, use proper techniques for blood pressure measurement, take the blood pressure measurement needed before we tell the patient to have blood pressure or not. I will dwell on that a little bit more later. And document accurate blood pressure reading, average the reading, and provide blood pressure readings to the patients. Now, cuff size. I think all clinics should be supplied with different cuff size. Obesity is very prominent in this part of the world, and I think we need to make sure that we have appropriate cuff size in all our clinics. Now, this is very important. You see, out-of-office blood pressure measurements are recommended to confirm diagnosis of hypertension. In the past, so many years ago, we used to really use the office blood pressure measurement for diagnosis and treatment. Not anymore. So important to get the patient involved, to provide him with the sphygmometer, and I hope his insurance will cover it or he can buy it. And in conjunction with telehealth counseling or clinical intervention, we should really rely on home blood pressure measurement after educating our patient how to do so in following the treatment effectiveness. Now, I'm not going to go over this slide in detail, but what the take-home message of this slide, when you have patients, look at this clinic blood pressure. For instance, if your clinic blood pressure is 160 over 100, and home blood, this corresponds to home blood pressure 145 over 90. And daytime ambulatory blood pressure 145 over 90. So we should keep in mind, in general, that blood pressure in the office tend to be a little bit higher than the home blood pressure or the ambulatory blood pressure readings. So we should not really rely on this number alone to increase the dose. And so we should, that's the take home message of this slide. Not every patient needs to have ambulatory blood pressure. It's very cumbersome. But self-monitoring with digital sphygmometer at home and sharing the patient knowledge, I think that will be very helpful. This is a very simple slide and give us idea what's happening. See, people who have normotensive, then their blood pressure in the office and at home should be normal. Sustained hypertension, both office and home blood pressure numbers are elevated. Now, white coat hypertension when their blood pressure is high in the office, but yet ambulatory blood pressure and home blood pressure might be. Again, blood pressure categories. Repeating myself, but just remember, normal less than 120, elevated this range, stage one and stage two. This is very important. I don't know how many of us are doing so when we measure the blood pressure in the office or we spend a few minutes educating that blood pressure. Accurate blood pressure, patient have to be seated this way, relaxed, uncrossed legs, no talking during the measurement or between. The cuff size had to be correct. And the arm level should be at the heart level, more or less. I think this is so important. Also have the patient wait at least 2 to 3 minutes before we check blood pressure. I think at least 90% or more of us, I didn't do any statistics, are not doing that. I think the patient come to the office, we are so busy, all of us, the patient sit down, check the blood pressure, go. And maybe we talking to him, maybe the room is open, and I think this is give us a lot of false reading. So what I do in my clinic, when I see the number from the, it doesn't sounds right, we repeat the blood pressure measurement in our clinic. I think this is so important not to rely on the initial blood pressure if you think it's not correct. And the other thing is the first visit also, please check blood pressure in both arms. So important to make sure there's no coarctation or other illnesses. Take only one more minute, but you could be able to diagnose very, because blood pressure should not be different more than 10 millimeter mercury between arms. And when it's a little bit different between both, you tell the patient, we're gonna go with the higher arm. For instance, left arm 140 millimeter over 80, the left right arm 130, then you indicate the patient to check blood pressure in the higher arm all the time. Now, what are our objectives? I think the objective of treating this silent killer to improve survival, to achieve target blood pressure control and optimize tolerability and adherence. And I think those factors are so important when we think about treatment and about prescriptions. So recommendations for initiation of medications. Last one recommendation, the initiation of antihypertensive therapy first line can include thiazide diuretics, still have a role, calcium channel blockers, ACE inhibitors, or ARB. I will talk about beta blocker later on, but usually it's not initiation of antihypertensive therapy. Now, when do we start monotherapy versus combination? Initiation of antihypertensive therapy with two first-line agents with different classes, either separate or fixed-dose combination, is recommended. Note this. This is very important. In adults with stage 2 hypertension, I'm talking somebody, for instance, a blood pressure of 150 over 100, an average blood pressure more than 20 systolic, 10 diastolic above their blood pressure target. For instance, your blood pressure target in this patient, for instance, 130 over 80, if his blood pressure 150 over 100, then he is a candidate to start with two agents from the first time. Yes, sometimes we start with one agent, but keep in mind that it is class one recommendation, particularly if he has comorbidities, somebody overweight, diabetic, a smoker. I think we have large number of our patients doing so. And you diagnose hypertension is 150 over 100 or 160 over 110. Do not be shy. Do not have inertia. Be assertive, and you may consider starting with two agents. Now, the last line here, initiation of antihypertensive therapy with single agent, reasonable in adult with stage one, and blood pressure goal of less than 130 with dosage titration. Now, this is kind of a busy slide, but there are two or three take-home messages. Definitely, for adults with confirmed hypertension and no cardiovascular or greater than equal to 10%, atherosclerosis, vascular disease, event risk. What do I mean by this? I'm talking about this closely. If you go to Google and look at AHA, ACC, or European Heart Cardiovascular Disease Calculator, to spend 1 minute in each patient, and that will put the age, will put the blood pressure, smoking or not, and then if his risk is 10% or more, then definitely you have to start therapy immediately. Now, people with confirmed hypertension without additional markers, your target is less than 130 or 80. And then treatment of hypertension definitely is recommended for people who are over 65 years of age. I mean, the people of my generation, and few of them are in the audience, I know. So many years ago, we used to think that it's okay, every 10 years of age, you're allowed to have higher blood pressure. Your age of 50 or more, then it's okay, blood pressure 150. Or if your age of 70 or more, it's okay to have 160. Not anymore. Now, if you really, you're not in institute or very fragile, you're active, your age of 65 or more, then your goal blood pressure should be 130 millimeter mercury. It's not acceptable anymore to say, no, you're, it's okay. Only for older adults who are very fragile, and we might allow blood pressure to be 140 to 145 systolic or diastolic 80 to 85. But more or less, the numbers are easy to remember. Now, monitoring strategies. Do we give a prescription and come back in 3 months? No. I think what happened, we need to follow up and monitor after initiation drug therapy. Control should include systemic strategies, including home monitoring, use of ambulatory blood pressure, or home techniques. What I find it really very helpful, just home blood pressure monitoring. I mean, the patient loves it. If you take your time and tell him you need to have the arm, not the wrist one, the arm digital sphygmomanometer, and teach him how to use it and tell him at least for the first 2 weeks of initiating the therapy, he should really write the numbers and write it down. And then you communicate with him back either in the office or with telehealth and tell him that 80% of the varices at least should be at the target, and you teach him what the target and you tell him why. I mean, when you interact with the patient, you don't just write prescription and tell him bye-bye, nice meeting you. Then the best patient is the well-educated patient. When he have insight into his illness, then you can hear, you can get the results. So achieving, but how do we achieve the target blood pressure? This simple slide. If you're younger than 65, then your goal really should be more assertive. 65 to 80, then 140, 130 to 140 maximum. If you're older, then it's okay to your similar range. As I said, except especially when you have comorbidities. Now, new strategy. How do we improve blood pressure? Preferred use of two combination. I'm repeating myself, so important. So we shy away, we are away from using single low dose. So in most of the people with hypertension, single pill treatment strategy preferred for most patients. Simplified treatment, preferred use of ACE inhibitor ARB combination with calcium channel blocker and thiazide-like diuretic. The core combination
for no blood
clots. Again, for most patients, you use this combination and you add beta blocker for special indications. So, single pill initial dual combination should include ACE inhibitor or ARP plus calcium channel blocker or diuretic. Step two, in 2 weeks, you follow up the patient by teleconsult or in the office. It's not working. Then you put ACE or ARP plus calcium channel blocker plus diuretic. So three medications. Then step three, resistant hypertension. Then you add spironolactone or other diuretics, alpha blocker or beta blocker. Remember, beta blockers are not off the shelf. Consider treatment of beta blocker when there is specific indication. Patient with hypertension and heart failure should have beta blocker. Patient with hypertension and angina, or post-myocardial infarction, or atrial fibrillation, or younger women, or planning for pregnancy, or pregnant. Beta blockers are very safe to use in pregnancy or lactating mothers. So remember their specific indications, either alone in pregnant women or add on therapy for a specific situation like heart failure, angina, or post myocardial infarction patients. Now, you remember I said earlier, we do things to improve survival. We don't only treat numbers, right? How we do that? But this mechanism of action of ACE inhibitors, I'm not going to bore you with it. It's very basic. Always, I think, although they put in the guidelines ACE or ARP, I always start with ACE inhibitor. I think there's more studies to prove their effectiveness and survival. And people who develop cough or side effect, then we can move them. Cough, not any cough. Cough that little bit hacking cough, like within a few days to a week or two, a patient come back with this combination, with this kind of cough, probably it is related to ACE inhibitor, and you can move them to ACE blockers. Yes, definitely drugs which expert their antihypertensive effectiveness over 24 hours should be preferred. I mean, look at this slide. I'm just putting those as examples, I mean, not to promote any medication, but in real life, perindopril from the ACE inhibitor, amlodipine from the calcium channel blocker, and dopamide from the diuretics have the longest, what we call trough to peak ratio rate. So they last longer. Others will last good enough, but probably those agents last longer in the body and probably provide more 24-hour coverage compared to other agents. Now, remember that ACE inhibitors and calcium channel blockers effectiveness on the vessels, two different sides. Calcium channel blocker, vasodilator, ACE inhibitor work on the endothelium. So what the summary of blood pressure threshold and goals? Now, look at this. This is very easy to remember. Looks like boring slide, but remember, whether you have clinical cardiovascular disease or your risk calculation more than 10%, this is your threshold of treatment, your patient more 130, your goal should be less than 130. And that's it. If you go across the board, that's it. The guidelines make it much easier for now. Whether your patient diabetic, have chronic kidney disease, have heart failure, ischemic heart disease, stroke prevention, remember your blood pressure average 80% of the time should be less than 130 over 80 millimeter mercury. Very simple. So these are my references. And the slides would have the take home messages. This was the previous slide, but the take home messages, I can read it for you and the other slide set. Number one, hypertension is very prevalent in this part of the world. Number two, remember that diagnosing hypertension is not easy, it's not simple task. It will take time and effort in our busy life. And number three, educate your patient, please. Patient need to be educated, and when the patient is well educated and about why you need to treat him and how he controls his blood pressure at home, how he brings his homework back to you, they will love it, then you have better results. And, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Abdul Razak. That was really a very comprehensive, simple to understand, yet a completely updated overview. And I'm sure everybody who's attending has benefited from that. And hence, our patients will also benefit. I'm Dr. Neha from Health Plus, and I just want to invite questions now. If anybody has any queries, any individuals, case scenarios that you want to ask Dr. Abdul Razak, if there's anything you want him to repeat or any other questions, you can either raise your hand or you can post it on the chat box and I will ask Dr. Abdul Razak. In the meanwhile, we are posting on the chat box the post-test survey, which is again, just a short 5-question set, which we would like you to do on the online survey. This is not just for us to understand how much you like the lecture, but also for us to submit to DOH for your certificate of attendance. I think Dr. Huda, you have a question. Please go ahead. Dr. Huda Mustafa, yes.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Neha, and thanks, Dr. Abdul Razak. That was a wonderful lecture and overview to the topic. I just want to raise up the question or the query of some patients or physicians who would like to add aspirin to patients with high blood pressure. What is your take on that?
This is a very important question, Dr. Huda. We used to think that aspirin prophylaxis in people over age of 50 with hypertension and or diabetes is good. Not anymore. We learned in the past 10 years or so that the risk of adding prophylactic aspirin carry more harm than benefits. We give aspirin definitely to people who have myocardial infarction, stroke, or who have more than three risk factors. I'll give you a scenario. Somebody is 68 years old, diabetic, hypertensive, smoker, overweight. We might consider getting aspirin. It's not even class one indication in this category, but not in simple hypertensive and or diabetes.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Samina, I think you have a question.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Neha, and everyone for arranging it. And Dr. Brazak is always very useful listening to yourself. My question is regarding, you know, you put figures in for diagnosing hypertension. Sometimes we have patients come in to us and they, you know, they are borderline. So, for example, I would say maybe like 140 systolic, 90, and they want to try lifestyle modification. Patients are usually reluctant, you know, they don't want to go on medication. Just want to touch briefly on the risk. Is there the risk of microvascular damage at this sort of blood pressure levels? Until when should we try this lifestyle intervention before we decide that actually we need to now move them on to something?
Very important.
Thank you.
Dr. Samina. You see, I hope, I'm so happy for this question. I do not mean that whenever you diagnose hypertension, you start medical therapy. No. According to the guidelines, if you have more comorbidity, you have hypertensive, overweight, with diabetes, and smoking, probably it's more urgent to start antihypertensive therapy in comparison to somebody who come his age of 38, who have no comorbidity, blood pressure 140 over 90. Definitely, I think lifestyle modifications, including DASH diet, exercise, tobacco cessation, and then come back in a couple of months with home blood pressure values. We part of the education to tell him that our goal with this lifestyle, and it works very well actually in those patients. I mean, this, if we quitting alcohol, decreasing or quitting smoking, exercise, low salt diet, high vegetable, works very well. So definitely we do not start pharmacological therapy in those low risk individuals.
Okay, thank you so much. And if they have the ambulatory blood pressure readings and those readings are showing more than 70 or 80% high readings, but when they come into clinic, sometimes the vice opposite also happens. You know, when they come into clinic, the reading is normal, but when you go on the home readings, the readings are high. So for them also, we would recommend to start the treatment.
Yeah, this is what we call masked hypertension. This category, when people who have masked hypertension, their normal blood pressure in the office, but high. Yes, if you start lifestyle and yet your ambulatory blood pressure and or home reading are elevated, treatment is indicated.
Thank you, Dr. Abdul Razak. Yes, there is a question asked by somebody that what is the cutoff point for blood pressure to start medicines at the first time reading? And a similar question has been asked that can we decide from the first one high BP about the management of the patient?
Well, I have the proper slide in front of everyone. Yes, if you have to remember your numbers. What is the threshold in different comorbidities and what is your goal? If somebody is low risk patient, your goal of blood pressure should be less than 130 over 80, that lifestyle. Again, if it's higher, high risk patient and or lifestyle did not work in a few weeks, then your cutoff, you do not accept one over 130 over 80. Your numbers, 80% of the values in the office and home should be less than 130 over 80 millimeter mercury. And I really think this is an important question. I need to underscore this because when we accept blood pressure reading 140, 150, you have higher chance of complications. I hope that answered it.
Thank you, Dr. Abdul Razak. Dr. Tahira, you have a question for Dr.
Yes, Dr. Abdul Razak, thank you so much. This was an excellent presentation. I would like to know, Dr. Abdul Razak, what's the latest guidance on the interpretation of the home on the ambulatory blood pressure?
Dr. Tahira, you are muted. We cannot hear you.
Your first dose.
Yeah. Dr. Abdul Razak, thank you so much. This was an excellent and very comprehensive presentation. I would like to know, Dr. Abdul Razak, what's the latest guidance on the interpretation of the ambulatory blood pressure readings? Like, is it the percentage or is it the average of the daytime readings? So what's the latest update on that, please?
There are three conclusions we get from the ambulatory blood pressure reading. We get the median number and we get the average. Is it high in more than 70% or 80% of the time? The third one, is it more daytime or nighttime? That will help us to individualize the treatment and the time of the day. So there are more than one advantage of the ambulatory blood pressure. But yes, to summarize it, if you have more than 50 or 60% of the values, more than the acceptable guidelines, more than 130 over 80, then he's hypertensive. If it's more, if majority of numbers are normal, then he's not hypertensive.
Thank you. Okay, any other question, Dr. Tahira? Yeah.
One quickly, Neha. The average of the daytime readings, Dr. Abdulrazak, does that, do we take that into account to make conclusions as well?
Certainly, we look at the average, we look at the time of the day, you know, look at the profession of the patient. It's so important. Mm. Somebody who have blood pressure normal at home, and he go to the office, and during the daytime, if most of the time it's high, then we know it's stress-related, work-related. Yes, we do average it. I mean, if he has only one or two numbers elevated because he was on the phone, in the meeting or something, but yet majority of the numbers are normal, then no need for treatment. Yes, so we do average it. We look at the peak, we look at the median, we look at the time of the day, and discuss those results with the patient. We show it. I enjoy it when he comes to the office and show the chart and tell him what is this test mean.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Razak. There's another question on that. Somebody has asked, what is the best time to check the BP?
There is no best time. I always tell them, please check it randomly. This is real life. Don't look at the watch. Don't say 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. We tell part of the education to have the patient check it randomly. We need real life. Check it when you wake up, take it middle of the day, take it early in the evening, but write it down. And I think this is the best thing to do.
Thank you. Dr. Ibtihaj has a question. Dr. Ibtihaj, if you would like to ask now.
Thank you, Dr. Abdulrazak, for this excellent informative session. So my question, any updates in diagnosis of hypertension during pregnancy?
Well, the same. We are very pregnant women are very dear to our heart. And we are very careful. They're blood stringent, you know, and this blood pressure should not exceed 130 over 80. And we do not accept borderline. We do not let them go on lifestyle. We start immediately drug therapy. If we diagnose hypertension, three readings, different times of the day, we should make that diagnosis, not based on one number only, but we should be more assertive. Yes, it's no new. We're still very assertive in treating them, making their most reading less than 130 over 80, and using safe medication during pregnancy.
Oh, thank you very much.
Thank you, doctor. There are some more questions on the chat. If we start the medicine once, does the patient has to take it lifelong, or can it be stopped? And if we stop, how do we assess the BP again, and like, how can we reassess and restart if needed?
This is very common fear of the patient. I mean, it's a myth that majority of patients think once we start them on medicine for blood pressure, they're gonna stuck for it for a life. So part of the education that if we feel that the patient needs a blood pressure medicine, we tell them it's not addictive. We're gonna treat them and see how things are going. If there are modifiable risk factors like obesity, smoking, alcohol drinking, high salt diet, we tell him there is a good chance once we go parallel, like a train track, medical therapy and lifestyle, and reassess, there is a good chance we might stop the medicine if lifestyle modification worked very well. So it's a very good question. And the other thing is, how do we stop and reassess? Yes, if we feel somebody cut down their weight, they cut down their salt intake, they stop drinking alcohol, cut down their smoking or quit, and they're doing exercise, and blood pressure is coming low now at 110 or 100 millimeter mercury, we can safely stop and have the patient check home blood pressure and come back within a week or two with home bleeding. And then if the still numbers are good, we say congratulations. That's it.
Thank you. I hope that is clear to Robbie, Raji Robbie. There's a question from Ali Amora. What is the effect of antihypertensive drug half-lifetime on the timing of drugs?
You see, half-time is important. I saw that some agents have longer half-time. But in reality, this, if you take your blood pressure, for instance, 8 in the evening, and as a matter of fact, we encourage patients to take most of the medications in the evening, unless it has diuretic, then take it in the morning, because the maximum blood pressure usually is early morning hours. Now, the half-life, in reality, doesn't have much effect. Most agents work well. They do not just disappear when their half-life finish. So I think the best thing is to home monitoring, blood pressure, office monitoring, and then real time will tell us whether this medicine needs to take it BID or once.
Thank you, doctor. I think there are a lot of questions still coming in. If you're okay to take some more.
I'm fine.
Thank you. Yes, we do have some time. So there is another question about something called fast drug metabolize for management of urgent hypertension. Is that clear? Leva Ahmed can ask if they have any other query.
Clarify, what does he want?
Yes, we'll wait for Leva Islam Ahmed to ask the question. Meanwhile, there's another question. If the BP at home is normal, like just 130, 120 systolic, and the ambulatory is more than 150, does that warrant treatment?
Yes, if ambulatory, if reliable home measurement in multiple occasions is normal 100% or 90% of the time, and the ambulatory is high, we have to really think about it. Because sometimes the ambulatory is very cumbersome. I mean, something pressing your arm every half hour during daytime, every 1 hour, wake you up at night, sometimes give us falsely high numbers. So I usually don't do both. I do one thing. If there is doubt, then I will rely on home measurement more. I mean, if it's real discrepancy. But most of the time, they go hand in hand. When you have reliable home measurement with educated patient, and ambulatory blood pressure show us 80% of the time is elevated. Usually it's true elevation.
Okay, yes, the clarification for the previous question has come. They want to know the first line treatment for urgent hypertension.
Well, it depends what's the urgency. Are we talking about somebody who is pregnant with high blood pressure? Are we talking somebody who is 55 years old with signs of stroke? Are we talking of somebody who has acute myocardial unstable angina? I mean, let me clarify. If somebody with impending stroke or unstable angina or heart failure, those patients should be hospitalized and give them sublingual and or IV medication under close monitoring in the hospital. Now, for people who are asymptomatic or minimally symptomatic with very high blood pressure, with comorbidities, this we can treat them safely in the office. We get consult here and there with somebody with blood pressure, for instance, 190 over 100 or 110, but it's totally asymptomatic. For asymptomatic, safely start treatment as outpatient, monitor them within a day or two. Once they are symptomatic, if you call it urgent or emergent, they should be treated in the hospital. Now, first line treatment for those patients as outpatient, if they're minimally symptomatic or asymptomatic, as I said in the slides, we start with combination of ACE inhibitors and or ACE blocker with calcium channel blocker at the same time.
I hope that answers your question, Leva Islam Ahmed. If there are any more questions, we can still take some. Any questions, any comments, anybody?
Just one, while if you still have time, Dr. Abdulrazak, the efficacy of the ACE inhibitors and ACE ARBs, any particular drug which you would recommend first line? The studies have shown some have a greater efficacy than the others or safer to use.
I think for ACE inhibition, I found they all work very well, but I find Hirindar rail, which have longer half-life and very effective as wide dose. We start with 5 milligrams, we can go to 100, I mean 10 milligrams once a day, combining with calcium channel blocker. And for calcium channel blocker, amlodipine is the most widely used. And what's the other question?
ARB.
ARB, I guess they're similar, more or less. But I guess Valsartan or any other agent, more or less, I don't think there is major difference in their classes of medicine.
Any other question, Dr. Samina?
No, thank you. Thank you so much.
One more question is there on the chat, Dr. Abdul Razak. They're asking about the diet. Raji Robi is asking about any special advice for the diet.
In general, diet should include low salt diet, meaning no added salt, no pickles, no junk food, and low caffeine, high vegetable diet. What we call DASH diet. I think soon DASH diet, if you can Google it, you know, it's going to be in the guidelines. I think these most Mediterranean are familiar with this. High vegetable and a balanced diet with low salt and low fat. Of course, we should really remember to ask patient about, again, I'm a tobacco expert, but I think we overlook this sometimes. We ask patients, do you smoke? Because one of the causes of resistant hypertension or worsening hypertension is smoking. Most people now, they say, I don't smoke, but they do use electronic cigarettes. I think any kind of cigarette can increase blood pressure, whether it's shisha or midwaf or electronic. I think they should be counseled and they should be referred. And I want to remind everyone that we have class one tobacco cessation program in Health Plus. So please encourage your patient to consider this very important risk factor, which might improve their blood pressure and overall the morbidity. In addition to, of course, checking their glucose, cholesterol, checking their weight, and address all comorbidities.
Thank you for that, Dr. Abdul Razak. There's one more question on salt-sensitive hypertension diagnosis and treatment and SGLT 2I effects on pressure. Do you have any comment on that?
Yes, I mean, for salt, I think majority of diet should include low salt diet. I mean, average salt intake, I don't know statistics about UAE, but probably the same thing, similar to the US. The average salt intake here between 6 and 10 grams. I think the acceptable should be 2 to 4 grams of salt. I think if people have junk food or pre-prepared food, sometimes salt intake can go up to 15 grams. We notice, I mean, as part of the education, when you tell the patient go on low salt diet, we come back and the blood pressure is still high, go in details or referring to the dietitian. So there are some patients who have salt sensitive. Blood pressure respond very well to low salt diet. Some people don't. So I think this is, go with the, what was the other part of the question?
SGLT2I effects on pressure.
Yes, I mean, now our colleague endocrinologist have a great help. There are some classes of newer diabetic medications have good effect on cardiovascular mortality, morbidity, including improving blood pressure. And this one class, the one mentioned in the question, one of them. We don't use it to lower the blood pressure, but we notice that people who have taken this class of medication even have what we call uricosuric effect, I mean, or diuretic effect. So go to the bathroom more often and blood pressure might improve. But should not be considered as antihypertensive agent, but it can have favorable effect.
Thank you so much, Dr. Abdul Razak. There is one last question. I think about BP. Yeah, they've just given some comments. Somebody has thanked you for the presentation and has said that it's very enlightening for him because they're already prescribed Concur 2.5 as preventive therapy post-angioplasty. So they enjoyed your session. And I don't think there are any further questions. There is one question about the safest antihypertensive for a pregnant lady. I think you mentioned it. If you can just tell the audience again.
In general, beta blockers. I mean, like labetalol. I just said good example or other class of beta blockers are very safe. I think, but hopefully the very important to control their blood pressure, no matter what. But I think in general, beta blocker classes are safe during pregnancy.
Thank you very much for that. So I think we can now wrap up the session if there are no more questions. While we're just waiting one more minute for everybody to think of any last minute questions, there is one. There is one for BP measurements. Mercury-based sphygmomanometer is better or electronic BP apparatus is better?
Really, I think digital sphygmometers around the arm are the best. I think these are the best. But patients have to be educated how to measure it, have to be the correct cuff size, have to the body positions sitting with arms uncrossed and not talking, and with his forearm semi-flexed. I think spending a few minutes telling the patient about these things play a big, major role. Because if the patient go and buy anything, get the wrist one, or get small cuff size, might come with falsely high numbers. So sometimes when I'm in doubt, I ask the patient to bring the home machine with him to the office and then look at it and re-measure it in front of us.
Thank you. And one more question. I think your session has really made people think a lot. If a patient comes for the first time with no previous history of hypertension, but BP is 160 by 100 and patient is just having headache, what do you suggest we do to manage this patient?
Actually, in the last few weeks after the COVID vaccination, I got a few patients who were surprised to find out when their nurse, prior to give them the COVID, their blood pressure is high. So first of all, headache, most of the time, have nothing to do with the blood pressure. I mean, if it's severe headache or blurred vision, it could indicate TIA or some complication. But a simple headache is not related to the high blood pressure. Now, first time, 160, we do not diagnose. The patient have no comorbidities, we ask them to come back again to do home blood pressure readings or provide him with the ambulatory blood pressure recorder and then make diagnosis and use the time to check their comorbidities. I do not let them go off the hook easily. I mean, this patient come, ask about smoking, check their weight, and ask him when was last time had sugar or cholesterol check. To my surprise, not to my surprise, I think I'm very, all of you are used to this now. A lot of patients, their 40s, 50s, or sometimes early 60s, never have a blood pressure check before or blood test for any reason. So this opportunity to educate them and check everything. So yes, the simple, quick answer. No, we do not diagnose, we do not treat with one reading 160 over 90. We have to diagnose properly the way I said it earlier.
Thank you so much for that. So I think, yes, now we can wrap up the session. Thank you so much, Dr. Abdul Razak, for such a wonderful presentation and being so patient with all our questions. Thank you for all the participants for attending. For those who are requesting for a recording or a presentation, we will see how we can help you there. But we have a set of take-home messages that we will probably think of try to send it to you with your certificates once the surveys have been completed. So I will encourage everybody to still go on the chat and complete the post-test survey and the evaluation. Best to do it right now so that you don't forget later and you will get your certificates on time. I would like to thank the marketing team, Farha, Jihan, Munthar, Kathy, for being there for us and for organizing this so beautifully without a hitch. And of course, I would like to thank the entire CME team, especially Seher, Sonal, Salva, Dr. Ittihaj, and of course, Dr. Huda, for all the motivation and all the hard work. I hope everybody enjoyed it. I hope everybody learned something today. And we will have another weekly session on general medicine topics, gynae, fertility, etc. So please keep a watch out for those and do join us again. So thank you once more, Dr. Abdul Razak. And thank you, everybody, for being here.
Thank you. Have a great day. Bye-bye.